Good evening. Welcome to the Monrovia City Council meeting for Tuesday, July 3rd, 2012. We will begin this evening's meeting with an invocation by Chaplain Terrence Brown and Pledge of Allegiance by Councilmember Tom Adams.
Let us pray. O Lord, in light of the upcoming celebration of our glorious independence, we pause to reflect on your love, grace, and mercy you have so graciously bestowed upon our nation and beloved city. We recognize the wisdom you have supplied to make sound strategic decisions, the peace you have provided to overcome worry and doubt, the courage to face every challenge with confidence and strength, the hope to know that better days indeed lie ahead. As always, I humbly request that your presence overshadow these proceedings, that you provide effective and viable solutions to our current city challenges, and that we conduct ourselves in a manner that truly reflects your love and attitude of goodwill towards all. Amen. Amen.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic from which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have roll call, please?
Councilmembers Adams.
Here.
Shetland.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Garcia.
Here.
Mayor Lentz.
Present. And Mr. Steele, can we have a report of the closed session, please?
Thank you, Mayor. This evening, prior to this meeting, the council met in closed session. It was a joint meeting of the City Council and the successor agency to the Monrovia Redevelopment Agency. Discussion and status reports were held regarding the three items on the posted agenda. The council took no reportable action on any item.
Thank you. And now we move to our presentation. The first presentation, The first presentation is a very, very special presentation. It's not a presentation I think we want to make, but it's a presentation that we should make and that we are grateful to the person we're making it to. We have had an extraordinary human being who has been part of this city in its government for more than 30 years. This human being started as a council member, was a mayor, and then has been on our planning commission, has been a planning commissioner for the duration of the time up until last week. Eric Faith was one of the best and strongest change agents this city ever had. This city well for decades. You can come on up, Eric. And we are sorry that he now feels that it's time to hang up his shingle and not work with us in this capacity anymore. But I am sure Mr. Faith is not going away, that Mr. Faith will be here to give us his much needed guidance, his expertise, and his knowledge. We have a special plaque for you, Eric, because we could not have done what this city has done. It would not be the city we are in today if it were not for you. And this is a little plaque, but it's full of tons of love and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pounds of appreciation. The plaque says, Commissioner Eric Faith, in appreciation and recognition of your dedicated service, the Monrovia City Council gratefully acknowledges your generous support and vital input on the Monrovia Planning Commission from June 1984 to June 2012. That's just the time you spent on our Planning Commission. The time you spent prior to your election to City Council and the time you were City Council member and a mayor adds up to more years than some of us have even lived in this city. And we appreciate everything you've done so very much. I want to give this to you. First, I want to allow you to say something to us if you would like.
Well, the first thing I'd like to say is happy birthday.
Thank you.
I remember it every year because it's also my birthday.
Oh, I know. We share that.
Whenever anybody gives me credit for starting the redevelopment process here in Monrovia in 1974, if you can believe that, I point to the fact that it's the staff of the city that does this, the hard work. It's the staff that you need to be protective of and provide a working environment that can make them, let them be creative and distinguish themselves with great works. And I just hope you keep that in mind. But between my wife and I, we've figured it's about 50 years that we've devoted to the city. And believe me, it's been a lot of fun, or I wouldn't have done it.
Eric, on behalf of an extremely grateful city, we present this to you. We're going to come down and take some photos with you. And you know, in spite of being, and in addition to being such a great part of our history of the city of Monrovia, he is a wonderful human being. And we truly cannot put into words the gratitude for everything that he's done. And he will continue to be there, I'm pretty sure. We also have another commissioner from our planning commission who I do not see in the audience, and I'm not seeing Susanna Culp, okay, who also has been a planning commissioner from 2006 to 2012. So that's 6 years that Susanna has been very dutiful in helping us shape our city. Susanna is stepping down as well from the planning commission. We have a lovely plaque for her, and I'd like us to give her a hand, and we'll make sure that she gets it. Year, our officials in Sacramento actually do something that we like. One of the things they do is they recognize the small business leaders from our cities. And this year, they're recognizing a small business leader who has been working in this city 25 years? 25 years. Gloria Haas has owned and ran Monrovia Floral. And this, again, is an award that is so overdue. Gloria Haas has been part of this community, an integral part of this community, for decades. 25 years, if not more. And because she worked in this in Monrovia Floral before she purchased Monrovia Floral. She is an integral part of the Old Town Merchants Association, working on their filming committee. She is also a member of the Monrovia Arcadia Duarte Town Council, where she helps steer the direction of the community in the county area of Monrovia, Duarte, and Arcadia. I want to, we're going to present Gloria a certificate of recognition, and I want to read this to you, and then Gloria, I know you do not want to speak, but I know this, but maybe you'll surprise me. No. We applaud to Gloria Haas for being the 44th Assembly District Small Business of the Year Award 2012 awardee. We applaud you for your initiative and hard work as the owner-operator of Monrovia Floral for your many contributions to improving the economic health of our community, truly making Monrovia a better place to live and do business. On behalf of the entire City Council, Gloria, come on up and let's give you your certificate. This is a wonderful night for recognition because we have another recognition that is very special. The people who protect our children as they walk to school are angels. They're the people who make sure that our children get to the schools safely. They protect them. They protect the motorists. They make sure that everybody is safe on their route to school. And this evening, one of our crossing guards has decided to retire, and we want to honor him. Robert Wiesenat, did I say that correct, Robert? Wiesenat. Robert has, and you know what, I see you almost every day. Robert does a fabulous job, and he has decided it's time to hang up the crossing guard. But we want to thank you for all the years that you have provided safe routes for our children. We have a recognition for you. It reads, to Robert Wiesenat, better? Wiesenat, in recognition of his contribution to the community through countless hours of making busy streets safer for our children as they travel to and from school. Robert, come on up. We want to present this to you. Congratulations. Here. Sorry about that. I would like to call up our recreation specialist, Memo Chavez, to explain what our next item is on the agenda.
A waffle.
Was that a surprise to you, Memo?
They wanted to say a few words.
Okay, go ahead and introduce them and let them. But I haven't even said what this is yet, so you need to introduce the whole thing.
Okay, I'd like to introduce our youth commission, Gabriel Martinez and Brenda. They're here to talk about the recreation month, so they have a few words that they would like to say.
Great.
On behalf of Youth Commission, we are excited that the City Council has proclaimed July as Parks and Recreation Month. As youth leaders and residents, we understand the importance parks and recreation plays in the community as well as in our own lives. Don't forget to visit the park tomorrow for the fireworks show. Also, please take a look at the Department of Community Services brochure for all the fun classes and activities offered. Thank you.
Thank you. As Gabriel said, this month is Parks and Recreation Month, and we have a proclamation to declare this month's Parks and Recreation instead of reading the whole thing and all the whereases. I'm going to go to the now for. Now for I, Mary Ann Letts, Mayor of the City of Monrovia, and the entire City Council hereby proclaim June 2012 as Parks and Recreation Month and encourage all residents to use and enjoy our parks and recreation opportunities. Go out and have a great time in our parks. That's what they're there for. They're there for you. All of our neighborhood parks, Canyon Park, and very soon Wilderness Park. Enjoy yourself in our parks. Is there anything else, Memo? Okay. So I think we need some photo opportunities with these young youth commissioners. Yes, let's go get some photos.
We had to just stay down there.
It's exercise. Our next person that we're going to honor this evening is not with us. However, I do want to talk to you about them. Chris Shevlin, a resident of the City of Monrovia for nearly 30 years, was a graduate of Citrus College. About a month ago, Citrus College honored their most prestigious alumni, and Chris Shevlin was honored amongst them. So I want to give you just a little bit of the reasoning why Chris was selected. He has had a 35-year career officiating high school and college basketball. He has worked when he was officiating basketball, he worked for the NCAA as an official for more than 5 years, but has officiated many of the division championships all over this country. If you talk to Chris for any length of time, he will tell you about all the places he's been to, all the universities that he has officiated in, and he has wonderful stories about the young college people that he officiated in the games who are now pro players, and some who he thought he was sure would get there but didn't, but have amazing stories. Chris is not only just a businessman working for Chicago Title, he is a dedicated citizen to this community and to giving back to this community. He's been a member of the Monrovia Kiwanis Club for 19 years, where he was designated as the Super Distinguished Past President Designee in 1999 to 2000. He served as a board member of the Santa Anita Family YMCA and was named as the Humanitarian of the Year in 2010 from the, that was from the Unity Center, I believe. Oh, for the YMCA, sorry. And he has also been presented this very past year with his wife, Becky Shevlin, as the Love of Youth Award earlier this year. It is an honor to give this award to Chris and to honor him for for being chosen this through his alma mater. Chris is not able to be with us tonight, but I'm going to put it in the very capable hands of his wife, Becky.
Thank you.
And now, some may say you saved the best for last. And I have to tell you, we saved one of the most important members of our community for last. The Foothill Unity Center has been a staple in this city for years, decades. There was a time when it was a very small organization, food bank. And then they hired this young whippersnapper named Joan Whitenick. And Joan Whitenick got into that Foothill Unity Center and just made things happen. That organization has grown to serve more than five communities. I know five for sure, but I'm sure there are more. Oh, she's saying six now.
11.
She's saying 11 communities. The Foothill Unity Center has branched out. It is not just a Monrovia entity. It also is in Pasadena. So it's easier to serve people on the western side of San Gabriel Valley. Joan infused the Unity Center with things such as the back to school event, the Thanksgiving giveaway event, where people who would not be able to have a Thanksgiving dinner on the day that most of us take for granted and give thanks, she and the Unity Center ensure that those people have their Thanksgiving dinner. She is also she also brought the giveaway for the holidays and for the Christmas giveaways. There are hundreds of thousands of people who have been touched by the Unity Center, and Joan Whitenick was the leading force behind it for 17 years. Joan Whitenick has announced her retirement, and actually, as of last week, was her last week, and she's officially retired, which is probably why she can come here, because she now has time. I do want to announce that the Foothill Unity Center has hired an extremely capable person to replace Joan, and that's her sidekick for the last 10 years, Benny McFarland, 14 years. See, Joan is just going to keep me up on the step here. For 14 years, and that's Benny McWilliams, and we're very excited that Benny will be here. So as a community, Betty's going to be leading the charge, but she is only on the horse that Joan brought to the stables. So I would like to read to you the recognition that we have for Joan, and we all want to come down and give her our appreciation. This whole community and a lot more appreciate what you've done for the Foothill Unity Center, Joan. The City of Monrovia presents to Joan Whitenick, upon occasion of your retirement from the Foothill Unity Center as Executive Director, this certificate is awarded as a testimonial of the energetic and passionate service which you have contributed for the past 16 years in changing lives and truly making our community a better place to live. We extend our very best wishes for a continued success in your life's pursuits of traveling. Joan Whitenick, thank you. And let's come down and take photos.
Ray has the phone.
asked me if I wanted to talk. I would like to say a few brief words. I got it.
Well, I've been a Monrovian for a long time. I graduated from Clifton and from Monrovia Duarte High School and have lived in the Monrovia area here all my life. I want to say thank you to the city for, you know, you talk about all the wonderful things that happens at Foothill Unity Center, and I can tell you it doesn't happen without the support of the community. It simply doesn't happen. You don't give out, you don't gather millions of pounds of food to give to thousands of poor families.
You can repeat that, a million pounds of food.
Oh, we probably average between 3 to 4 million pounds of food a year that we're giving out. Last year we served in excess of 4,200 families, over 12,000 people. And we are not counting, there's no duplication there. Over 60,000 services were provided to our local families. So it's amazing, but it doesn't happen by just me or Betty. She's good. But it really takes the whole community. And I want to say thank you to all of the community. It has been an incredible journey that I've been allowed to participate in and be a part of. And hopefully Foothill Unity Center is now 32 years old. We'll go for another 32 or more. Thank you.
Thank you, Joan. Okay, moving along. We do not have a student government representative until school starts again. But Ms. Lyle, can you give us the order of the business, please?
Certainly, Mayor. As some of the members of the public in attendance might have observed, Kim Herney, Community Service Commissioner, that was going to be recognized tonight, was not available to attend tonight's meeting. So that recognition will either be rescheduled or we will send her the proclamation. The staff has received a request from a member of the public to pull off consent calendar items CC-5, which is the Chamber of Commerce agreement, and CC-7, which is the agreement with Madhouse Creative for preparation and work on the city's website, and would seek to have those discussed with some public comment. So that request has been made. And also we have received some requests to move certain items on the council reports forward on the agenda before the public comment period. So those are the changes that we have received requests on this evening.
Great, thank you. So I will now take up the consent calendar excluding CC5 and CC7.
Move approval.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, that motion passes. And the next item on our agenda, we're going to move up two of our council reports. The first one is mine, and it is the report about the Bookhouse Project. And what I'm going to do is call Elizabeth Schneider, along with some of our library board, teen advisory board, and they're going to explain to you what this all means, Bookhouse Project. Elizabeth.
Good evening, Mayor Letts and members of City Council. It is my privilege to work with these fabulous young men and women that make up the Library Teen Advisory Board. I'm honored to introduce to you tonight Amanda Monserbacht, our TAB High School President and a senior at Monrovia High School, Amy Leonard, a freshman at Monrovia High School and our TAB Volunteer of the Year this past year, Megan Matteson, TAB Middle School President and 7th grader at Clifton Middle School, and Amanda Eckroth, also a 7th grader at Clifton Middle School and one of our fabulous volunteers. They'll be speaking to you about a project they're working on right now called Bookhouses.
Thank you. Many teens cannot get to the library in our community because of transportation or family commitments to babysit brothers and sisters. Fines or lost books can also inhibit a teen's access to the library. Parents of families struggling to make ends meet may not have the time to stop by the library to pay fines on teens' cards, nor may not have the money.
To promote literacy and encourage a sense of community around reading, the Monrovia Public Library Teen Advisory Board is creating a project called Book Houses to be rolled out in the fall. Members of TAB will decorate boxes that will be placed in unexpected public places in Monrovia, such as fast food and pizza restaurants, parks, and local teen hangouts. The movement of miniature free libraries has swept the country with little libraries created by interested citizens totaling over 1,800 located in about 45 states.
These boxes will be made out of plastic bins and will include free teen books. The books will be advanced reader copies, discarded books from the collection, and donations to the library. Teens will find these boxes. When teens find these boxes, they can take the books with no restrictions. A sticker in the book will explain the book is free from the library and encourage them to pass it on to a friend. Teens can also keep the book to create their own collection. Adult and children's materials will also be included at a later date upon evaluation of the project.
TAB is currently researching locations for these book houses in the community. Possible locations for the book houses are Recreation Park, Boys and Girls Club, YMCA, Canyon Park, TAB members, and TAB members' front yards. Thank you so much for your time. Do you have any questions?
Are there any questions for this fabulous group of TAB members?
Keep us on our toes.
I want to tell you, that was wonderfully one of the best reports we've ever had in this city council. Thank you all so much. I do also want to say the last time I saw many of you, you were holding a ball in your hand on Monrovia Day and throwing it and dunking the likes of Mr. Garcia and myself. And this group of young people can hit a bullseye. But you sure hit a bullseye tonight with this report. What a fabulous idea, and thank you so much for bringing it to all of our attention.
Thank you.
And then Council Member Spicer is also going to move up an item on his agenda.
Okay, thank you, Mayor. First of all, I would like to apologize to the Mayor, the City Council, and our community and the people involved for my digressions. Some 30 years ago, I made mistakes that I am not proud of, but I am glad that I learned from them and feel by legal standards, at least, that I have paid my debt to society. My reasons for not publicly disclosing many of the details about a DUI, credit card violation, is because I paid what I was fined, I served my probation, turned my life around, and started giving back to the community by serving others. After which I petitioned the court to have those two incidents expunged. This was granted by the judge on July 23, 1992 at 9 a.m. and that penal code was 1203.4 of the Penal Code. The definition of expunge is to erase or remove completely, to blot out or strike out. That was my rationale for not disclosing that when questioned by the press. The incident involving my daughter and my spouse were reduced to a lesser charge. I completed counseling for anger management and parenting as the court required. My past has helped me to become a better person, a better spouse, a better father, and it groomed me to be a mentor and community servant. As evident that I am a different man today than I was 30 years ago, I ask you to consider my 20 years of marriage, my three beautiful children that I love and who love me. All three have been exceptionally successful. I measure their success by their academic and social achievements. One is entering her junior year at the University of California campus. My son has demonstrated strong leadership abilities at his elementary and middle school, with exceptions to be a high, with expectations to be a high achiever in high school this coming fall. My youngest daughter, which is my baby, is probably the most educationally gifted in our family. I'm a lifelong learner. My formal education was delayed until I retired from the military, from the Army. Once I made certain my children got a head start, I returned to college and earned an associate's degree this past spring. I spent the better part of my entire adulthood trying to do things in the community to make this city a city we all can be proud of. Though many of my contributions are not headliners, I have worked diligently to better my city by helping youth get out of gangs, preventing young persons from joining gangs, helping with community cleanup projects, being trained, teaching, and implementing the MAP program, participating as a Monrovia Unified School District watchdog dad, and serving on the community mediation team to reduce crime in the Monrovia, Duarte, and LA County area. Yes, I made some poor choices, but I have worked continuously to atone for those choices and hope this council and community will allow me to continue to contribute. When appointed to serve on the city council, I accepted with the intent to do the best I could. As God is my witness, I am still resolved to do that. Again, council and community, I apologize to you for my past actions and for not making this statement earlier. Monrovia is my home and it is dear to my heart. Thank you.
And next on our agenda is our public input portion. This is the time for anybody who would like to speak to this council that items that are not currently on the agenda may come forward and do so. Alice Atkins has speaker cards and she will call people forward.
Cyrus Kemp.
Good evening, Council. Some time ago, I attended the budget study session that the Council had and heard about the Council going out to different locations in the community and receiving feedback as to what services the community members felt they might be least impacted by losing or diminishing. I believe that was the way it was put. A big concern of mine, and I wanted to share some of my feelings tonight, is that I think that this community has already had a lot of services diminished. I know my street for one, and I drive around. I see many other streets in this community. I try to make a habit of visiting a lot of different areas. Are in very poor condition. And the kind of condition that pretty soon will require great sums of money to do the repair work that had it been done on a more timely basis, probably might not have been as costly. I know Mr. Adams expressed concern about some of the deferred maintenance, maybe us winding up like the city of Los Angeles, where we have water mains breaking or sewer mains breaking. I know Pasadena has that issue in a lot of areas now. And I don't really see the hard cuts at City Hall. You know, we talk about the employees picking up a couple of percentages on their on their retirement benefits, and that just doesn't really cut it. It's not going to make enough of a difference. I heard on the news today about Los Angeles employees taking a 5% reduction across the board. We could do a lot of outsourcing here. We could also make better use of volunteers. I think I've mentioned this before during hard times. I know there are a lot of people who are either unemployed and or retired, like myself, who would be willing to give some of their time to the community to try to make the infrastructure of the community survive in a better condition. And we don't have to reinvent the wheel here. I constantly hear about what other cities are saving with outsourcing. And like it or not, I think one day we're going to be forced to do that, but I can't see the wisdom of waiting, waiting until the horse has left the barn. And we're in a, you know, more of a financial straits to deal with these things. And I look at some of the, what I consider waste. Some time back, I asked for copies of the city cell phone bills. And I cannot believe the number of people who have cell phones on the taxpayer's dime. And it amounts to over $80,000 a year worth of cell phone bills. And I look at the car allowances that a lot of people receive. And it's big money. And, you know, the private sector expenses these things out. You know, if you get a couple of calls on your own personal cell phone that are business, then you expense it back. If you have to drive somewhere, you know, I think the IRS allows you 50 cents a mile, and you expense that back. And the good days are gone. You know, the days when the money was flowing like water, and we could hand perks like this out. And I think it's time that we look at taking care of the community. And I think that when I see just so many things like the last garbage increase. Okay, so maybe it wasn't a lot of money, but to me it was a backdoor tax. When I see the city get a franchise fee increase from 10% to 12%, that was on the backs of the community. And where does that money go? It goes to buy cell phones and big expense accounts for auto allowances. It just doesn't feel right. And I think that this city, along with crying about what the state is doing to it, needs to realize that you're doing the same thing to the community here. You are the state as far as we're concerned. And I think it's time that you really begin to make some hard cuts. Do those studies. I've heard about so many cities have gone to the county for the fire department. The fire department costs us a lot of money here. And these guys are constantly making problems. They're suing the city. They're creating necessities for arbitration. They're wasting everyone's time. It's time to go with the county. You know, they've become too political over there. They're not a fire department. They're a political machine. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob Bartlett.
Mayor and City Council, thank you for allowing me to speak this evening. First of all, Mr. Spicer, that was a wonderful declaration, I guess you would call it, and I think you did a great job. I've known Mr. Spicer since he was a young boy, and I know him to be a good young man, and I know him to be a good man and a good father. But before I say any more, I want to thank Mr. Adams for nominating me for that seat.
You're welcome.
Thank you. That was a nice thing for you to do. But Tom, I also want to say one other thing. I don't believe everything I read, so I want to ask you, did you ask Mr. Spicer to resign or give up the seat that he's been assigned?
Did you say, have I asked him to?
Yeah.
I have not.
You've not made that statement at all?
I have not. I was asked by the press if I thought he should. And based on the information I had at that time, I said, yes, I thought he should.
Do you feel the same way now?
No, I don't, actually. Okay. And I appreciate Mr. Spicer's comments this evening.
Okay.
And I accept that apology.
Okay.
Well, then. And I think, but let me finish, Bob, as long as you've engaged me.
Yeah.
I think that the big crime is not what occurred in the past. The big crime was not acknowledging it. Because a lot of good people in this town have been running around defending Larry Spicer because they like him and they believe in him and they were misled. I've had people come to me and say, oh, none of this happened. We've got neighbors who were told, no, none of this happened. And as it turned out, an awful lot of it did. And it's the same thing every time someone tries to not be honest up front is when you get into bigger trouble. I think if Mr. Spicer did what he did tonight a long time ago, he would have garnered the entire respect of this community. But when you wait, things get worse, and they get worse, and more gets uncovered, and in the long run, it becomes even more embarrassing than it needed to be. But I appreciate you being here, Bob.
Okay. Well, I was going to say a lot more tonight, but I don't think it's necessary at this time.
Right.
Okay? I don't want to engage you anymore.
It's always, but it's always good to see you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
And Larry Spicer is a really good man. Okay.
Yeah. Ernest Gonzalez.
Good evening, council members. Happy 4th of July. My name is Ernest Gonzalez. I'm a homeowner, property owner, and business owner here in Monrovia, and I'm proud to say it's been that way for 57 years, except for the years I went to college and law school. I'm also proud to say I'm joined here tonight by my wife, Sally, my eldest daughter, Alex, who left work early as a paid summer intern at Caltech, and my youngest daughter, Katie, who I think foregone a volleyball practice with her club volleyball at the San Gabriel Elite. I'm here to show support for someone I've known for, I'm going to embarrass this, Larry, close to 50 years. Larry and I met when we were in third grade when he was at Huntington School. I was at Monroe School when we met on the playgrounds. At that time, there was a young employee in the city of Monrovia named Don Hopper coming through as a Parks and Recreation employee. It was guys like that who showed Larry and I the way. Larry and I stayed friends through our graduation when we all got together at Clifton School with the Hoppers, the Spicers, Holmes, and a lot of other names that are pretty well known in this city, including myself. I'm known as Nesto. We graduated Monrovia High School in 1973, and that's where Larry and I kind of parted ways. I went to college and went to law school. Larry and I hooked up when I came back, when I moved my business from Arcadia to where I bought my building here in Monrovia, where I'm happy to say I've been for, I think, close to 20 years. I know about Larry's problems. Right, I helped him with those problems. And I'm here to say that, you know, we all make mistakes. And the issue of whether it's disclosed or not, it's an important issue. And I'm very glad that you said what you did tonight, Larry, because, you know, I don't know what you disclose or don't disclose. But I do know, and maybe there should be some input from the city attorney, that if you're charged with a misdemeanor, as an attorney, my understanding is once you complete your term of probation, all right, and the judge releases you on your misdemeanor conviction, that is wiped off your record, and you don't have to report that anywhere. Larry was good enough for our country to serve in Korea in the Army, where he got some distinguished honors that I didn't know about until he talked my ear off on the walking trail. And, you know, for our country, to have someone like Larry risk his life speaks a lot for him today. I mentioned that Larry and I met when we were in grade school because at that time, he went to Huntington School and I was at Monroe. At that time, our city had a segregated school where all the African Americans went to Huntington School. And that's, you know, something that happened, and there's nothing we can do about it. And everybody makes mistakes. This country's made great mistakes, but we've overcome it. You know, and I think the fact that Larry made mistakes, and whether he disclosed it or not, I don't think is the issue. I think what the issue is when Larry comes to this job at night, is he prepared? Does he do his job? And that's what the focus should be. You know, politics today is, you know, what have you done and what can we dig up on you? I'd much rather see you spend your time, and it's valuable time. I mean, I'm here in the evening, you know, what I'd rather not be, and you're here, and I'd rather have our city council spend the time on the important issues of the day, not on something that happened 20-something years ago. Thank you for this time. Thank you.
Betty Thomas.
I'm going to make this very brief because of what was just said.
Betty, and please come to the mic. Come to the mic.
I'm coming.
I'm just going to say ditto from what the gentleman just said and Bobby Bartlett's comments. I've known Larry a long time, too, a long-time resident of Monrovia. And I'm not saying this because, and I want to make it clear, because of who Larry is. I'm saying it because who Larry is, and it has nothing to do with the fact that we're the same shade, except he's just a little more shadier than I am. But because this place is Monrovia is so important to me, and to be represented in Monrovia by all of you, you know, all of you are my representatives, and I like the rainbow effect. And that's all I'm saying is Larry's a good man. I've known him a long time. We fellowship together. I know his wife. I've seen his children are just well behaved and smart. And Layla, she's just, I mean, she's got potential. And I think I told Lawrence he's going to be the next black president of the United States. I mean, these kids are really good. So something had to be right there. So I just want to say ditto. Ditto. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Lois Gaston.
Thank you, Mayor and Council, for allowing me to speak. I am just thrilled to be here tonight. Eric Faith has been a hero of mine for years. He's helped in so many ways, my family, my church, this community, and of course, Joan and Gloria. I hit the jackpot tonight, and I came really and truly to help explain why I feel the way I do about Larry Spicer. But before I do that, I want to thank Council Tom, just call you Tom, council members, doesn't matter. Thank Tom for sharing some dialogue with me yesterday that kind of brought this whole issue to my attention. And I applaud you for what you just said about not asking Larry to step down. Let me tell you that my relationship with Larry goes way back to the time that he was a teenager and grew up with my kids. Well, he wasn't a teenager, he was preteen. He's always had potential. He always stood almost as the leader of the pack, the mature person that everybody depended upon. That puts a great deal of responsibility on your shoulder, and it causes you, in some instances, to become very protective of yourself and others around you. But I didn't really get to know Larry as a man until January 26, 2008, about 9 o'clock at night. I think you will all remember that was the night that Samantha Salas was murdered. The day after that occurred, we started gathering at my request, a group that we call the Duarte Mediation Team. We'd been meeting before to try to bring unity between the races, but then we really turned into high gear. And some of you were there, some of you may not have been there, but that first meeting, the room was full. The second meeting, there were only about six people that showed up. But since that day, ever since that first meeting, Larry Spicer has been one of the persons who's continuously been at the table to help us try and keep gang violence down in the communities of Monrovia, Arcadia, and the county area. He's done this in a number of ways. As a matter of fact, he was at one time the only person from Monrovia that showed up at Duarte's mediation team meeting. We examined things that we thought were underlying causes, and we sent people out into the community to work on those causes. Larry took on the Duarte Hawks, and I've seen him work the snack bar. I've seen him call me in the middle of the night and say law enforcement wasn't here, and whatever it took and needed to be done, I've seen him working with people and with by himself to get it done. And no press was there that could have seen that, but he got the job done, and that program, of course, went off the list of bad groups in the city of Duarte and onto the list of very respectable services provided for kids. I've also watched him work the Sherman Avenue address, where the suspect, or as the convicted persons lived, that actually was convicted of killing Samantha Salas. I've watched that whole street change, and I believe this city got a national award for that revitalization of that community. I've watched, Larry didn't do it by himself. I mean, Christine Bennett, Ulysses Gutierrez, there are a number of persons I could name that have worked tirelessly to be sure that this community was safer today than it was in 2008. I've watched him at Second Baptist Church go to extreme personal expense and time and talent to help families and members of our congregation or members of the community who simply wanted to use our facility in making sure that the families and the guests were taken care of, like bringing in closed circuit TV and taping and whatever. Many, many things, not his job, not his duty, just did it. I've watched him in the Monrovia schools. It's rare that you see a parent who can afford to be at the schools, at the elementary, the middle school, high school, whenever needed and when not needed for their kids. And he wasn't there for disciplinary problems. He was there for support and helping with other kids who needed. His kids weren't the problem. There were other kids that were the problem, and he was there. When his kid needed the support, he was there. Now, I say that because in addition to that not being possible for a lot of parents, it is extremely, extremely rare when it's an African-American parent who usually has to work or run a business. And Larry, it's usually a woman, but Larry has been there for those times. I've seen Larry at Victims of Crime Memorial. That's when we really and truly try to help those families who have had tragedies happen because someone murdered someone in their families. There's no one in Monrovia, but perhaps the mayor was there, I was there, but he's gone on years when I couldn't be there, helping people that we don't even know, that don't even live in this community, who've suffered like some victims suffered that did die in our community. So I thought I wanted to mention that, and I've seen him every single year. I miss a year, but he tells me he's there. Supervisor Antonovich has an event for veterans and services to veterans. I've seen him administer to veterans. You know, it's hard to explain that in this world that we live in, there are no perfect people. There are people who try to make restitution for whatever they've done. I really feel that Larry Spicer fills that role. There are lots of people that I have served with, but I would not want to be on the front line of any battle with anyone more than I would want to be there with Larry, because I really feel he would protect me. I really do hope that the hearsay and the old records that supposedly were legally closed or sealed will not taint this community and destroy what I think we need, and that's people who can fall down but get up and still be productive. You have a productive man in this person. So thank you for hearing me out. Thank you for hearing me out. There are lots of people who serve in that capacity that don't deserve to be in that in your chair as council members. Larry Spicer is not one of those people. Thank you.
Pam Fitzpatrick.
I'm Pam Fitzpatrick, 412 South Myrtle Avenue. And I came here tonight thinking the atmosphere was going to be different. And maybe this is a lesson for all of us in another way as well. You get narrow, you read a little bit, you read blogs, you look on Facebook, and you know, one day you write something and then somebody doesn't hit like and you think, oh my goodness, nobody likes me. And then you come to reality, and this is our reality. This is process. This is honesty. I'm proud of you, Larry Spicer. I haven't known you very long. I didn't meet you until not too long before I know I stood up here and asked that the council consider you for an appointment to Clarence Shaw's seat. And I did it because of the awards you had won, because of what I had heard about you, because what I saw, and because I had to beg you to stop calling me ma'am and say, my name is not ma'am, it's Pam. And I said, there is an honest person. That's a person who, in private and in emails and everywhere, is polite to me, not just in public. And I treasure that. And I thank you, and ditto to everybody here. I'm standing in good company, and I'm a happy person, and I thank God tonight for the truth.
Thank you.
There are no other speaker cards at this time. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this council about any item that is not on the agenda? You may come forward. Please give us your name.
Thank you so much for hearing us out. My name is Miriam Childers. I am a resident of Monrovia and have been since 1985. I've had the privilege of, or 83, sorry. I've had the privilege of knowing Mrs. Larry Spicer since we were in high school. We went to high school together. And then I've had the privilege of knowing Mr. Spicer. Oh gosh, Larry, for what, 20 years or something?
Yes.
Anyway, and I have to tell you that when I heard that Larry was in our city council, one of the things that actually went through my mind was how wonderful. You usually get the popular or the, you know, and I mean, the most amazing respect for all of you. You guys are amazing and you serve our city very well. But a lot of times, sometimes the people who should be serving us are not there. I don't know if I'm explaining myself, but when I heard that Larry was here, I thought, we are so blessed. We are all so blessed, because I know Larry in private, I know Larry in public, I know Larry for 20 years. He has been just the most outstanding, unbelievable person. Everybody has mentioned his record of volunteering, his service to the schools. He is just a very self-giving person, and when I heard that he was in this chair, I thought, we are very lucky, and I'm very happy that will continue. I just want to thank you all for your time, and I want to thank you, Larry. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council members. My name is Delphine Spicer, and I've been reading all these problems and issues going on in the on the different websites and patches and things of that nature. And as I stated in our last meeting, a lot of the neighbor allegations was from all of this alleged allegations 10 years ago, and I was saying how people are just coming forward now because he's Larry Spicer, and if it was so cruel in nature, why didn't they come forward before? But everyone wants to supposedly talk now. But what's most surprising to me is from our own council member, Tom Adams, which, you know, really disturbed me. It seems as if you only heard the neighbor's supposed allegations as opposed to hearing Larry's side of the story. I even saw a quote in the paper where you had said, Larry is not a nice guy. Councilman Spicer has an unmistakable pattern of bullying. And why would Mary Ann Lutz appoint a bully to city council? But you, Tom Adams, you were at the same city council meeting that everyone else was when our neighbor came and, you know, voiced his allegations. So my question is, did from that time, from that two meetings, is that when you based your opinion that he has an unmistakable pattern of bullying, he's not a nice person?
Would you like an answer to that?
No, not right now.
I didn't think so.
And why would you, Councilman Adams, base your statements on what you heard at the two city council meetings? And the alleged allegations of Councilman Spicer give you the right to basically declare, you know, what you were quoting in as the paper. And do you always base your opinions on one-sided stories? Are you a truth seeker? And do you, Councilman Adams, as a team member of Larry Spicer, did you ever ask him, were these allegations true? Did you ever ask him there was any validity? Did you ever ask him for his side of the story? And you always preach this this platform of transparency, but seeing everything clearly, did you practice this when you stated these allegations in the paper about his character? You only heard and you only chose to hear one side of the story. So basically, I'm asking, was the entire situation transparent to you? But no, I think instead you chose to work in the background and try to destroy him. And then you, Councilman Tom Adams, had the audacity to provide the media with a background check on Councilman Larry Spicer. What was your true motivation to do so? My question is, for what purpose? You never had his best interest at heart to begin with, in my opinion. Because as I look back on the council member, when he was appointed as an interim councilman, you showed your non-support during the process by being quoted in the paper as calling it a setup, and his vote. And then I remember when his vote was taken, or when the council member's votes was taken, you uttered loudly, absolutely not. And if you have this much hate over him being appointed as just an interim, he's not going to be there forever. What would your attitude be if he was elected, ran and was elected and was on a full term as yourself? So I think when our neighbor came to the city council meetings, I bet you said, voila, I've got something. And at this point, you kind of, instead of asking your fellow council member what was going on, you decided to contact the neighbors and began your own archaeological dig. And you now became the new spokesperson for them, or should I say you were their new quarterback. You now called the plays in this lynch mob, and it's playing out well in the papers. And one of your big plays was to provide the media, or however they got it, with a copy of his background check. And to me, in my opinion, and no one else's, you really defined to me what dirty politics is all about. That was a dirty play, and the referee, they didn't let the touchdown count. And when you saw that the issues on his background were somewhere almost 30 years ago, you still came forward with the information, and you kept running the play. Maybe you, Councilman Adams, are the one who needs an archaeological dig in your past. Is your slate clean? Has it always been?
And I'm not sure what other plays that you're trying to run that you might have in mind, but just let your game be fair and let it be a clean one. And now you're being quoted as saying, well, now you're not saying that he should resign. But my question is, when you're saying he should resign, who's the true bully here? And Councilman Larry Spicer, he works for the citizens of Monrovia. He doesn't work for you. And the council members are here to handle the business of the city and its citizens, and not to bicker over someone's background or form opinions on one-sided stories. And as I stated weeks ago, I said by God's grace and mercy, the bite of the venomous cobra had no effect on Councilman Spicer nor myself. We are still standing. Councilman Larry Spicer is a strong man and has served his community for over 21 years in the United States Army. Something as evil and vindictive as this will not break him. And I, Delphine Spicer, am equally as strong. You cannot break us. You cannot bend us. Like the palm tree that blows in the wind, at the end of the storm, it's still standing tall and strong. And there's an old Cherokee saying, proves that how the cow runs away from the storm while the buffalo charges directly towards it and gets through it quicker. Whenever confronted with a tough challenge, do not prolong the torment. Do like Larry and I, become the buffalo. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this council on any item that is not on the agenda? Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public comment. And Ms. Lyle, I was wondering if you could respond to some of the comments that Mr. Kemp had made.
Certainly. Put my page back to my notes. Mr. Kemp and I actually met, and he expressed some of these issues to me about a week ago. And I do appreciate the comments that he has provided us with respect to his views on our budget situation. And he did correctly indicate that our intent is to go out to the community and seek some public input with respect to our strategic goals for our community, and also to establish some priorities for our budgeting process. And as Mr. Kemp has indicated, I share his concerns with some of our deferred maintenance decisions that we've entered into. I think that we need to take a look at how those deferred maintenance issues can be reconciled. And all of the comments that he made, I don't believe that any of them are inappropriate to look at for budget cuts. So we will take those into consideration as we move forward with our process to do priorities and evaluate our expenditures.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And I would like to have an opportunity to respond, if I may.
Sure.
Mrs. Spicer, I find it interesting that you've said that I've made my mind up because I've heard one side of the story, and that's because that's the only side I have heard. I've waited for quite some time to hear the other side of the story, but Mr. Spicer's been reluctant to tell that other side of the story until this evening. Matter of fact, a month ago I sent an email through channels to hear the other side of the story, and Mr. Spicer failed to tell us the other side of the story. I think he felt he didn't need to. So now that I've heard the other side of the story, you've heard my remarks. But we've waited a long time to hear that other side of the story, and I think what was most troubling for me, because one thing that I believe very strongly in is open and honest government, and we've had a group of your neighbors that have come down here for months complaining of your husband being a bully. And as far as I could see, and as far as they've told me, no one seemed to want to help them. This wasn't a crime committed 30 years ago. This wasn't a crime committed 20 years ago. There were crimes committed 13 or 14 years ago. And then there was the ongoing dishonesty about this, the ongoing dishonesty 2 months ago, that we were led to believe that your neighbors were just a little crazy, perhaps, because all of this was being made up. Now we know that's not true. Now we know that's not true because people have dug deeper and found out the facts. So now that the facts are out and the apology has been issued, I've accepted that. But you see, when I only hear one side of the story, and when the other side of the story chooses to remain silent, it leaves me no other choice. So in the future, as I said earlier in my remarks, when people get into trouble, and we all do, none of us are perfect. The quickest path to solving problems is to be open and honest about it. And as soon as you do, most people will accept that. If you choose to remain silent, then you leave people's imagination to run wild. And I'm sorry that's happened. I think this should be resolved now. I'm hopeful it will be. And I appreciate your comments.
Mayor?
Thank you.
Can I speak?
Absolutely, Mr. Spicer.
Yeah, remember, there's two issues here. Number one was the issue with the arrest, right? Now we're talking about the other side of it, which is the neighbors. I didn't respond to the neighbors because I knew that I didn't do these things, so why respond to them? Also, when I became a councilman, we were given a sheet of paper with each individual's name and phone number on it. So why do I gotta go through the media in order to talk to a councilman? Why couldn't he call me and talk to me? But it's over with, I'm good with it. I know nothing's going on in my neighborhood. Regardless of what's being said, I know in my heart nothing's going on, and I'm not worried about that.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on with the agenda. The next item on our agenda is to convene the Monrovia Housing Authority meeting without adjourning the City Council meeting, and we'll take up the matter. Roll call, please.
Board members Adams.
Here.
Shevlin.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Vice Chairman Garcia.
Here.
Chairman Lutz.
Present. We'll take up the matter of consent calendar.
So moved.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Motion carries. And now we will reconvene the Monrovia City Council meeting and take up matters of the council member reports. And I'll start this evening with Mayor Pro Tem Garcia.
Thank you. And you know, I have listened to the dialogue here this evening, and I would like to put in my thoughts on that. I know that as Councilmember Spicer pointed out, nobody's perfect. I think all of us understand that, and I think one of the things that I know that I respect about Mr. Spicer is the fact that he had the courage to come out and apologize this evening. Again, sometimes uncertainty is probably the biggest problem, you know, and not knowing. And I'm glad that you know, I have a lot of respect for Mr. Spicer. I don't know Larry that well, but I do know that he has done a lot of good in this community, and it was the knowledge of that good that gave me the thought to condone his appointment. And again, I appreciate you stepping up tonight, Larry, and owning this. And I'm glad, hopefully we can put this thing to bed and move on.
No problem, Jim.
And on a different note, I would just like to take the opportunity tonight to wish everybody in our community an amazing 4th of July. We have a great event that we're going to have tomorrow that's going to give us an opportunity to all share here in fellowship with all our community members, and I'm looking forward to seeing all of you out there. So happy 4th of July, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Adams.
Just happy 4th. Hope to see everyone at the park tomorrow. I think the concert starts at 7 and the fireworks at 9. It'll be a wonderful evening. Some great sponsors, great music, a lot of fun, and hope to see you all there. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Shevlin.
Thank you, Mayor. I too would like to make a couple of make a couple of comments. As Larry said, when this first came up, and I believe it was at the first council meeting in May, I believe that's when it was, when one of Larry's neighbors came and spoke before us, I called Larry immediately and I said, hey, what's going on? And so we had a talk, and I talked to him. I talked to him at length, and I felt his explanation was very reasonable. I also know that there were conversations with city staff about mediating this issue with the neighbors. So steps were taken to interact with this neighbor. It wasn't just like, oh, go away. So there were steps taken. And in today's technology, I often talk to my daughter about that. We depend so much. We've got all of our little gadgets here, and we're communicating either on the blogs or through Facebook or whatever, but so much is lost, and it's all it would take is to pick up that phone or even see you face to face and say, can we take a couple of minutes here and can we just talk? And I think there's a real tale of caution here when we take our business to the blogs and we air all that. It doesn't work out. It doesn't work well. And people get hurt badly, and you can't take it back. People don't have the facts, and they say things that maybe then later they would have liked to have taken back. But when you go out in a blog or a newspaper or something like that, and you say things about people that you haven't taken the time to talk to the person or you really know, it is tremendously damaging. And I know I've had it done to me. So, tale of caution. Think about it and give that person the benefit and go to them and talk. So, on a much happier note, I always like to plug the library, and especially during the summer, and we had the great kids here earlier. Our library provides a lot of free events. I encourage you to go to our website, city website, and through that you can get to the library website and check out all the various things, where it be Wednesday night dinners in the park or the Monday night movies, all those things. Our friends of the library are also having a half-price book sale during the month of July. And the prices, I understand, go from 25 cents to $2, so there's some real good deals. Get yourself a great book to read. You can even, the library has their summer reading club going on. It started June 11th and it goes through August 4th. So check out all the great things that are going on in the library. Great things. And then for our 4th of July celebration, we are starting up, there will be the concert with Person to Person. And then the following Sunday, we are going to start off our community services summer concerts in the park. The first of eight, we'll have eight of them, will be upstream, and that's Calypso music. So come out and enjoy all the great things that we're going to be doing in the park and around town. And I also wanted to say thank you to everybody and to thank staff for the cleanup day that we had on June 24th. It was awesome. And Rotary and Kiwanis and some other community volunteers got together and we cleaned up lots of trash. But don't wait for a special day. You can do that anytime, any day of the week. Like I said, when I hike up in the canyon, I always take my little bag and I always pick up trash, anything I see along the way. So please be good stewards of our town, our down, anywhere. It doesn't even have to be in Monrovia, anywhere you go. So I know I've bugged my daughter on many a vacation, and we take a little trash bag with us when we go on a hike and we pick up trash. So at any rate, I just wanted to say thank you, and I hope we can do some more cleanup around town, but don't wait for a special day, any of you. And happy 4th of July, and have a great summer. Thanks.
Thank you. For my report, I have a couple of things on the agenda. The first one is the appointment of the Historical Commission Commissioners and the Monrovia Old Town Advisory Board members. And as I explained at the last meeting, I will explain it as again, the openings come once a year, and we have an interview panel that consists of the chairperson of each board or commission, the city staff person assigned to that board or commission, and the city council liaison to that board or commission. We had some interviews that we duplicated after the last meeting, and these are our results from those duplications. And so for the Historic Preservation Commission, Mayor Pro Tem Joe Garcia, being the liaison, was part of the interviewing panel. Jimmy Hendricks from the commission, who is he the chair or the vice chair at this chair? He's the chair, okay. Steve Sizemore from the Community Development Department, and Craig Jimenez from the Planning Division, interviewed people who are interested, and at this time, their recommendations to appoint are Donna Baker, Mary Ann Lee, and Tim Shea to the commission, each for a term of 3 years. And I will make that in the form of a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. The next commission where we have an appointment is the Old Town Advisory Board, or MOTAB. Councilmember Becky Shevelin, who is the liaison to the MOTAB board, Dan Bell, management analyst, staff member to the board, and Chairman Brian Whelan, interviewed applicants and their recommendations. They interviewed applicants prior to today, and I believe you had two interviews, Ms. Shevelin, that were re-interviewed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, two interviews, and the committee recommends the following appointments: Rudy Castrillon. I'm not saying that right. Vanessa Del Rio and Dr. Kevin Mikado, each to a term of 2 years, and I will make that in the form of a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you. The next item on my agenda is a recap of the CEO's broker reception. Now, many of you may not really know what that is, but it's something we've been doing in this city for a very long time. And what we do is we gather some of our largest employers in our city together, and we put them in a room. We don't lock the door, but we close them. And we have conversations with them about business in Monrovia. Sometimes we talk about what we can do. We ask them what we can do to help their business. Sometimes we provide speakers. Last year at our event, we provided a speaker from the Los Angeles Economic Development who talked about what was happening in the economy and giving us forecasts. And she even gave us a forecast that she was going to present the following day. We got a little preview of it, so it was fascinating. This year, we took our broker's reception with CEOs, and we added into the mix our real estate brokers for business brokerage. And we had this sponsored by one of our businesses in town. And it was completely sponsored, catered by businesses in Monrovia. So we brought all these people together, and they did great networking. What I want to do is give you a little brief overview of who was present. Such businesses that are new into town, such as Yogurtland, Chase Bank, Club Gymnastics, Snail's Pace, and Monrovia Dental Care were present, new businesses in our community. CEOs from some of our largest businesses and some who have been around for a long time, Unitech Mayachi, Sierra Auto Cars, and Aerotro were there. We also had representatives from some of our other businesses, such as ITT Italis, Merengue, the Gold Line was there, the City of Hope, and Tucumán, and then all of our brokers that came in. obviously, this was hosted at Mount Sierra College, so they were also present. And we had brokers and developers. We had representatives from the Chamber of Commerce, from our cable access station KGEM, from the Monrovia Unified School District, from the Duarte Unified School District, from the San Gabriel Valley Economic Partnership. All of these people came together in a room, and there was a lot of networking and meeting and business communication back and forth. And then we had a great forum where some of these businesses talked about what it was like to do business in Monrovia, what worked for them, what doesn't work for them, and where they see their business going in the future. It was a great group of panelists: Paul Kamel-Kamarian from the Wine of the Month Club, Paul Hambrick from Star Surgical, which if you don't know what Star Surgical does, it's an amazing company that has a procedure. It's not like LASIK eye surgery. They actually replace the cornea. It's an amazing company that is award-winning company right here in Monrovia. Christine Stapp from Mount Sierra College, who talked about all of the things the college could do for the businesses and vice versa. And Bob Machuto from the Los Angeles Economic Developments Corporation. Sorry, I wasn't sure if it was, well, that C was for at the moment there. They gave a wonderful overview, but the key to this event were the sponsors and the people who helped us, who made this happen, because we did not spend any money on this event. It was all by sponsorship. So we want to thank a very special thank you, first of all, to Mount Sierra College for hosting us, DoubleTree Hotel for giving us those wonderful cookies, London Gastropub who fed us, Trader Joe's, who gave us I was going to use a different word, the wine. Sienna on Myrtle, who also was able to give us some wonderful food for the event. These businesses helped make a business event happen, and we want to thank each and every one of them for supporting this event and helping us. And we also want to thank all of the attendees, because the networking that occurred has been fabulous, and the feedback that I've been getting on that night and from that night has been nothing but positive. So thank you very much, and we'll be doing more of these, and we'll be reaching out to all of the businesses in Monrovia. We want to make sure, now that some of our tools to help businesses in other ways are gone, that we make sure that our businesses know that they are an important part of our Monrovia team, and we want to help them in any way we can. The next thing on my agenda is Councilmember Spicer and I attended an event on last Tuesday. That was, I'm not sure what this was going to be when we went to, but I'll tell you what, it was amazing. We attended an event, a town hall meeting with the Council General of Israel, David Siegel. This was held at the Jewish Federation of Greater San Gabriel Valley and Pomona Valleys. And some of you probably know this facility in Arcadia as a synagogue, which it was a synagogue, but it's no longer a synagogue. It houses this federation of the Jewish synagogues in San Gabriel and Pomona Valley. And that's why this event was held there. And Mr. Siegel gave a wonderful overview of what's happening in Israel, what's happening in the Middle East, and it was fascinating. I know that Councilmember Spicer and I stayed afterwards and spoke to him about a couple of things that he had touched on. He touched on the way Israel uses water and the way that they recycle their water, and they have desalination plants. And that's a wonderful thing that, you know, America's just starting to look at. So it was a very fascinating discussion, and we were very pleased to represent our community at that event. And then I just have one thing that I would like to add to the discussion that we've been hearing primarily this evening. First of all, I think it would be silly to pretend that any of us are models of perfection. And it is only through the mercy of God that we're here and that we're able to make up for any things that we've done in the past. While this was unfolding in the last week, because I am a Christian, the thoughts that kept coming through my mind was the story where the town was going to stone the woman. And Jesus said, "He that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone at her." It kept ringing through my mind. We all need to be forgiven. All of us need to forgive. I believe this world would be a much better place if we would just remember that, and if we would live that. I believe that despite all of the differences that we may have as people, if we work together in that spirit of forgiveness, we will create a better community and a better world. And I encourage everybody to remember that as we move forward. And that's my report this evening. Now we'll move on to our next item agenda, which is our administrative reports. Administrative report AR1, which is the discussion of a disposition of the city's interest in real property located at 214 Madeline Drive. And I believe Ms. Lyle will give us the staff report.
Thank you, Mayor. This item is on the agenda to receive some direction from the council on how you would like to proceed with this item. And let me get some background information. And let me also assure you that we received the information from Mr. Ochoa last Thursday around noon. So there was very little time in order to put it on the agenda to provide you with any meaningful report, written report. So I apologize for not having more information in your packet, but let me go through that at this point. In 2004, the council agreed to a proposal that authorized Mr. Ochoa to receive a second mortgage on the house he was trying to purchase in the city of Monrovia. And that the documents that are important in that arrangement were the a modification to Mr. Ochoa's employment agreement, which was approved in May of 2004, a deed of trust, and a promissory note that were approved in June of 2004. And the essential portions of this agreement were that Mr. Ochoa was seeking to purchase a house that is in the neighborhood of $750,000, and the council authorized the extension of a second mortgage loan to Mr. Ochoa in the amount of $275,000. The council applied a 5% interest rate to this loan, and Mr. Ochoa has been paying pursuant to the deed of trust and the promissory note and the employment agreement on that note since it was issued in 2004. He's been paying on the interest of it, and to date, Mr. Ochoa has paid the city the interest payments accruing on that to the amount of something in excess of $100,000. Mr. Ochoa is seeking to sell his home in Monrovia, and because of the market, he is unable to sell the home for the amount that he bought the home for. And in order to repay the city's note, Mr. Ochoa has provided us a letter with some deal points that he is requesting some consideration of. I want to make it clear that Mr. Ochoa is not at all asking for any of his obligation to be forgiven. So there is not any request here that Mr. Ochoa not pay the full amount that is owing on that amount, on the second loan. Mr. Ochoa, at the present time, the deal points that he has put forth are that he would repay $200,000 of the $275,000 second mortgage at the close of his escrow. At the house that he has in Monrovia, and that the $75,000 that's remaining on that note would be secured through either his request as a personal guarantee with some of the assets that he's provided as copies of, or a separate note on property that is owned by Mr. Ochoa's family in Crestline. And so he's provided us with an appraisal on that property, demonstrating that the value of that property is $150,000. He's also provided us with some additional financial information with respect to some of his personal financial assets, and has asked that the council consider that as one of the ways to resolve this situation. When I review the promissory note and the deed of trust, there are sections in both notes that call for the lender can require the immediate payment of the full sum at the close of escrow. It's not obligatory that we do require that. And in the, and I believe it's the promissory note. Oh, it is. The maturity on the promissory note is 12 months after Mr. Ochoa terminates his employment with the city. So either the maturity date of 12 months, which would fall December of this year, or the close of escrow would be the time frame under which the lender, the city of Monrovia, could secure the entire full amount from Mr. Ochoa. The direction we're seeking from the council is whether or not you would request Mr. Ochoa to pay the full amount at the close of escrow, or whether you would extend him the ability to pay $200,000 at close of escrow, or some other amount that the council would authorize, and use the rest of the term on the promissory note to the December 2013 timeframe for him to provide payment on the rest of that amount. So at this point, I would just be seeking to get some feedback from the council on how you'd like us to proceed. We will have to go back, prepare the instrument, if any, to serve back to Mr. Ochoa for execution, and then return back for the council to actually approve that at some future date, if that's the direction you care to proceed in.
Okay. I'm going to ask if there are any questions, but prior to that, I want council to be aware that we do have a speaker who would like to speak on this issue. So, you know what, why don't we let the speaker speak now, and then we can ask the questions. Okay, Cyrus Kemp.
Good evening, council. First, before I say what I have to say, I want to bring forward a concern, and whether it's a legal concern or just maybe a moral one for the community, is I believe one of our council members has some conflict in participating in this discussion and vote, and that would be Ms. Shevlin. She works for Poodley, I believe, and Donna Baker is the agent who is handling the sale of Mr. Ochoa's home, and I believe, but I'm not positive, may be handling the purchase of the property in Glendale. So there's a pretty large commission at stake here, and the fact that they're so closely aligned, I believe, can possibly, jade her, decision-making ability in this instance, if it would cause the property maybe not to be able to be sold and purchased. I'll leave that, and I'll go on to what I want to say. I spoke against this loan when the council made the loan. I don't understand many things about this loan. Mr. Ochoa sold property in Mount Washington area and made a nice profit on that. And why our city would lend $275,000 on a second trust deed that was secured by a property that had absolutely not $1 of Mr. Ochoa's money connected to it, I've never been able to figure out. I've never been able to figure out how the property closed escrow before the council approved the loan. There's a lot of questionable things. This loan was supposed to be such a great asset to the city, secured, very liquid. I submit to you that at no time since that loan had been made to date would the city have been able to sell that note had they needed the money. You had a piece of property that had no equity in it. Mr. Choa didn't put one dime into it. We would have had to discount that paper heavily to get cash if we had needed that cash. Also tonight, I have heard talk of Mr. Choa paying $200,000 and us lending him $75,000. I think we're forgetting that this 5% loan was only paid with 2% interest, no principal, and 3% of that 5% was added back to the principal. So that $275,000 loan, Mr. Ochoa owes the city much more than $275,000. And somebody needs to do the math on that. I have seen his payment schedule, and he was making 2% interest-only payments to the date that I had requested. Now, it's been a couple of years, and that may have changed. I would doubt it, but it may have. But there would still be a lot of built-up principal on the back end of that note. And it's this community's money, and this community deserves to have that money. As far as Mr. Choa chose to leave this city, chose to go to a city where he was going to be paid considerable more money than he was being paid here. And at this point in time, I don't really see the wisdom of the city becoming a loan agent. They seem to want to justify this initial loan because, according to our city attorney, this was becoming commonplace, which is not, in fact, anywhere near commonplace, especially for a city like this. Beverly Hills is not Monrovia. The terms of that loan that were presented and approved by the council were totally different than the actual note itself. Now, whenever the city attorney addressed this matter, he didn't address the matter. He talked a big circle around it, which he's pretty good at doing. He never addressed the terms of the loan in the report that he delivered to the council, and what's written down on paper are nothing like the terms of the loan that Scott Ochoa signed. Scott Ochoa, in my opinion, is of questionable moral character. He was receiving a $600 a month automobile stipends, and that was to cover gas, wear and tear on his car, and he was turning around and turning gas slips in for petty cash. Double dipping, you know. There is nothing about his character that would make me feel comfortable about lending him 10 cents. But first, we need to get the figures right. $275,000 is not what Scott Ochoa owes. He owes considerably more than $275,000. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Steele, can we clear up the issue of Ms. Shevlin and whether she is able to address this issue?
Mayor, I need to speak to Ms. Shevlin about that before
okay.
I can give that
Should
advice.
Should we take,
so
a,
maybe
quick
take a quick break and I can have
okay.
that conversation?
Then we're going to take a 10-minute recess. It is 25 after 9, and we will reconvene at 9:35. Okay, we are back to order, and I'm going to start with Councilmember Shevlin.
Thank you. And I just want to say thank you to Mr. Kemp for pointing that out. I hadn't given it a thought. I'm newly employed by Podley. I have my real estate license there. I hadn't given it a thought that Ms. Baker has the listing on Mr. Ochoa's house, but yes, we do have that affiliation. I want to disclose, I get no compensation whatsoever. I have nothing to do with this transaction. But in light of transparency issues, I will recuse myself, and I will go in the other room.
Okay. See you in a few minutes.
I'll take my electronic gadget.
Okay. Mr. Alvarado, I would like to know if you could please answer the information that Mr. Cyrus asked, the question he asked about the accrued interest and the total amount, and can you decipher that for us and give us that information?
Yes, ma'am. when Mr. Ochoa left the city of Monrovia, he did pay up all of the accrued interest on the note up until the time that he left. So at the time that he left, the balance due was just the principal of $275,000. And since then, he's been continuing to be making monthly payments. So actually, the balance, since he left, he's been making principal and interest payments. So the balance now is approximately about $273,000.
Okay. So I guess we should amend our statement, the 275 to 273, when we talk about this.
Or you could say 275 approximately.
Yeah, for conversation purposes now, it's probably easy. We just keep it at 275. When we get to the details, we can get to the exact number of what the balance will be at the time that any documents are executed.
Okay. We have received two additional speaker cards. So I'm going to start with Mr. John Jogminas.
Thank you, members of the City Council. My name is John Jogminas. Regarding this loan, 5% simple interest, 2% simple interest payments up to date until just recently, on a zero down second trustee position. I'm just curious, did anyone who was on the council at that time review this promissory note with those terms and really think that was a good decision? Did you feel that this was in line with what he could have received at a commercial lending institution? And regardless of comments made by the city attorney that similar loans are made in other cities, I really have to ask, do you really think that's right? This is taxpayers' money that we're lending an individual who works for the city. I really don't think that's a good precedent, and it's a good place for us to be. There's people in this town who work very hard for their money, and especially now who are suffering to try and keep their home. And now we're talking about giving special terms again to someone who already got very special terms at the beginning of this loan. I think the council made a very big mistake when they approved the loan in the beginning and extending another loan to him, especially from what I've seen, it would just compound the mistake and really not be in the best interests of the residents of Monrovia. I think at this time when we are in fiscal crisis, we need the money. Hearing about the deferred maintenance on the city, we can't afford to be making any more loans. We need the money now, and we need to put it to good use. In the past, we've turned down pocket parks because we didn't have money. We've turned down other things because we didn't have the money. Giving Scott Ochoa another loan because simply he just doesn't want to pay it right now. I really can't believe he doesn't have the money or he can't come up with the funds. If he's got these other properties, he can take out a commercial loan against those and pay us back. That was his obligation and he should live up to it. If anyone on this council feels otherwise or if they feel some sense of obligation, then I look to all of you that if you want to co-sign his loan, feel free to do though, but do it with your money. Don't do it with ours. I don't think it's fair that anyone on this council look at the residents of this city as a way to fund an individual who's no longer wants to be a resident of this community. Regardless of what his position was at the time, I don't think it's relevant. He owes the money. He needs to pay it back. Thank you.
Thank you. And our final speaker is Mr. Scott Ochoa.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, members of City Council, Scott Ochoa, 214 Madeline Drive. I wanted to come before you tonight to answer any questions on this particular matter because there have been a great deal of discussion, some high talk, primarily chatter and opinion, and very little fact about what this situation really is all about. And what it is all about is the repayment and honoring of an obligation that we made to the city of Monrovia. I will agree with one thing that the previous speakers talked about, and that is that you want your money sooner than not. And that's really what this comes down to at the end of the day. The substitution of collateral was originally the discussion that we'd had, but it became clear to me, or was made clear to me by staff, that what the council wanted was to get repaid as quickly as possible with as much as possible. And so the terms that you have, the decision that you have tonight, is either to take, as was agreed to, $1,300 a month principal and interest payments for the next 6 months, or $200,000 immediately, and $75,000, I think, in the letter I gave you, in the next 90 days. If what you want is liquidity, if what you want is to have the majority of that money back as soon as possible, this is the way to do it. Alternatively, we can wait as the terms of the loan, and as we both honor the terms of that loan, dictate, then we will make the principal and interest payments between now and December. And in December, we'll replay this episode. But the idea here is to make sure that the council and that the community is satisfied with the full obligation, the full commitment that was made by my family to Monrovia and Monrovia to my family. That's it. We can argue about the terms of the loan. That's fine. But that, again, is something that has no bearing on what it is that's going on tonight. You can dislike what the loan represented. You may dislike me, as the two speakers have made it abundantly clear in previous statements. Doesn't matter with what it is that is going on tonight. Tonight you have a simple decision. If you would like to get the larger lump sum now and the balance, $75,000, $73,000 in the next 90 days, so be it. If not, then we'll go forward with the principal and interest payments between now and December. But I humbly, respectfully ask for your consideration, and I will abide by whatever the council's decision is. But I thank you for your time.
Thank you. In case there are questions for you, Mr. Ochoa, I'm just going to ask that you stay present. Thank you. Are there any questions of staff or anything else that we want to discuss? Mr. Adams.
Well, starters, and we've heard about when this loan was first cast, and I was on the council when that happened. I think it was the right decision at that time. Please remember that Mr. Ochoa did not initially ask us for the loan until we told him we fully expected him to come to Monrovia. It was not uncommon at all in that environment for this type of thing to happen. It's what the council wanted, and the Ochoa family did exactly what we asked them to do. So looking back at that time, I think it was exactly what the council intended. I think it served its purpose, and that brings us to today. I'm not sure that Monrovia is ready for us to alter the terms of that. I just think that there's an awful lot of feeling that has nothing to do with the economics of it, but has everything to do with the politics of it, that would indicate that this may not be the best thing to do to alter the terms of the loan and just move forward as originally agreed to.
Any other questions or comments?
I too was on the council 2004 when we approved that. I had absolutely no qualms about my approval of that loan. Exactly as Mr. Adams said, we asked Scott and his family to relocate to Monrovia, and he honored us with that. 2004 was a very different time. And unfortunately, there are a lot of people who are feeling the same effects of that economy downturn that Mr. Ochoa has indicated by what he's going through as well. And I guess I'm a little bit concerned here, in essence, and I recognize that I guess the easiest solution is to come back to the city and ask for an opportunity to cancel this out. I think my concern becomes the fact that are we setting precedent in essence for other members of the community who are in the same situation, who are hurting on their mortgage and are upside down, wanting to come to the city for a similar type of solution. And as Mr. Adams pointed out, economically, it seems like a very easy fix. I just don't know that I feel very comfortable at this point moving in the direction of continuing in that regard and not just honoring the initial loan the way it is.
Okay. Mr. Spicer, did you have any questions or comments?
No.
Okay.
I'm listening. I
have some questions, so I want to ask, actually, Mr. Ochoa, since you are here this evening. And then I have some questions for Ms. Lyle. Thank you for being here this evening. I think it's easier for us to get some of the questions that I've been hearing from the community answered. One of the questions that I've been hearing from the community is, why doesn't Mr. Ochoa just go out and get a separate loan for $275,000 and pay off this loan to the city?
Ultimately, ma'am, that is what we will do to take out the remaining $75,000. Going back to a previous discussion I'd had with council, the idea of substituting collateral was not objectionable at that time in December. And so with that in mind, although it was not the official position of the city, it was something that was stated in a separate meeting, we moved forward with pursuing a home in Glendale with that understanding that that substitution would be viewed favorably by the council. That is not the case any longer. It has made clear to me that the council instead, again, desires to be paid back as much as possible, as quickly as possible. But that basically is the reason why. If we end up canceling this escrow, we will eventually go and do just that. We are here at this point now. We have made the interest payments as stipulated in the note. We've come current. We've paid faithfully. We aren't looking for any type of relief on what the amount of the loan is. Even though the house we purchased was for $775,000, we're selling it for $739,000. I bring that up to demonstrate, not to ask for forgiveness for any part of the loan, but rather to say we're honoring that commitment. We aren't asking anybody to do that for us. We've identified a house. The housing market is extraordinarily tight right now, especially in Glendale, and that's not your problem. It's mine. But at this point, what we're asking to do is allow this to be expedited so that we can conclude our business much more quickly than we can under the original terms of the deal.
Okay. So this follow-up question to that is, okay, you need to sell the house in order to get the $200,000 to give to us right away. The other $75,000, why are you not going out right now to a bank to get the other $75,000 right now?
We are qualified right now, as you do in any kind of real estate transaction, to go and pursue a loan now undoes a great deal of, or complicates at least, a great deal of all that background work for this particular transaction. It would basically blow the timing of the escrow. And so if we don't do it, well, then we will just cancel the escrow. And that's not the end of the world. As I said at the outset, I will abide the council's decision. I'm not asking for any favor, only for consideration of a deal that gets you as much money as possible upfront and gets you the balance of the full commitment shortly thereafter. If the council so chose to put a time limit on the repayment so that you get the $75,000 guaranteed well before December of 2013. So you have the complete amount well before what the current note stipulates or calls out for. I'm willing to do that. Monrovia has been very, very good to me, and I think I've been very good to Monrovia. And so it is important to me that the council, as representatives of the community, are satisfied with the deal. And if you're not, that's okay. I'm willing to live with that. This is an opportunity that exists right here, right now.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Ms. Lyle, if I understand correctly, if I'm getting all this correctly, should the council decide tonight not to accept Mr. Ochoa's offer and make some sort of arrangements with the remaining $75,000, we will go back to what is status quo, which is his monthly payments, and we will not be, this note will not be due, and we will not be, most likely, not paid in full until December of this month, of this year, correct?
Under the provisions of the deed of trust and the promissory note, that's correct.
That is correct.
1 year from Mr. Ochoa's leaving the employment.
And then I guess for Mr. Alvarado, I'm hoping you know this. What is the current interest rate? Do you know the current interest rate for housing or a second mortgage right now?
I couldn't tell you a second, but a first is probably around 3.5%. A second, though, I maybe have to look at Mr. Adams.
I think Mr. Ochoa has an answer.
Madam Mayor, the pricing on a personal loan, not even a second mortgage, but at a higher rate, being a personal loan, is about 6.25. So therein, if the city, the reason why my proposal to you on Thursday started at 2 and ticked up every so often was to demonstrate to you and to everybody that it's in my best interest, for the most cynical among us, that it's in my best interest to take out the city as absolutely soon as possible. If the city would like to have a callable note that 90 days after close of escrow is due and you want it at 6.25, I'm happy to do that. I am looking for an opportunity to make sure that you are satisfied. And if you can't be satisfied, well then, as I say, that's okay. We'll come back and do this at the end of the year.
Okay, thank you. As to my opinion regarding this, I would like the city to be made whole as soon as possible. Waiting till December is not as soon as possible. I think Mr. Ochoa's offer of $200,000 at the time of his house closes escrow, and then having the $75,000 come after
within
90 days makes sense. What I would like to see, just as Mr. Ochoa just now reiterated, offered, let's put a date on it. I'm nervous with 90 days, so I think I would say 95 and give some leeway there. But a hard, firm date that the note is due, and let's use the date of 6.75% interest for this. That would have this city paid back sometime in October, far earlier than if we do nothing tonight and he continues in the path of just making the payments to us. That gives us a huge chunk within the next few weeks and a final payment in October, which is before this note becomes due. And to me, that makes sense for this city to have this money as soon and as quickly as possible. And I would also like, one of the options Mr. Ochoa gave us was to secure the note based on some real property that I believe is his parents' property. And I would like it secured to that property. That would be my recommendation for us to move forward, and I'm interested to hear what my colleagues have to say.
Well, I personally wonder, again, I mean, I realize that coming before the council and coming before the city seems to be the quickest solution, the easiest, I guess, method of trying to complete this transaction. I'm a little bit concerned, and maybe Mr. Choa can help me out here, why you know, what are the as you point out, the challenges that you're facing of, let's say, going to another source to get that similar type of loan amount?
Well, the only source that I know is a bank. No one I know has that kind of cash laying around. Now, I am qualified and locked in on a mortgage through PNC. Now, if I go and take out another loan application, that is going to cause that application to be reconsidered, and who knows if we lose the rate that we've locked in at, which is very favorable. Mortgage rates are very good right now. And that's my primary motivation at this point. If we do have to go out back to the two or three other banks that we've talked to do this, all that does is complicate the loan application on the first. That's at the end of the day, that's all that it is. Had I known that that the council's position was this firm on this matter, then we would have done just that. But that's not what my understanding was, and that's okay. As I say, I will abide by the council's ultimate decision.
Scott, and again, as I pointed out, okay, when we approved the original note in 2004, I had no problems with that. Those were completely different times now. I hope you can understand some of the, I guess, the challenge or the difficulty that I'm seeing here in looking at this situation here, knowing full well the rest of the community is undergoing the same type of scenarios that, you know, in terms of our economy.
Certainly, sir. And I think that it wouldn't be uncommon for folks in the community to seek some kind of loan modification that adjusts what the balance and the principal are, given where the housing economy is. I, on the other hand, am not doing that. I, on the other hand, am coming to you saying I will honor the entire amount, and I'll do so at a higher rate than what it is that you're getting now, which, by, as an investment, is more than what you're getting in the rest of your portfolio. If you think of why we were paying 2% of the 5%, during the term of my employment here, it was because that's what you were getting in 2004 in the local agency investment fund. And now local agency investment fund's probably about either, I want to say, is
half percent,
maybe, if that, maybe 0.33%. And we have trued up at the end of my employment to the tune of $60,000+. So as an investment, as an economic deal, and I'm sensitive to the comments that were made, it doesn't really matter of economics, it's more of politics. Well, I do understand that. But that's why I'm here on TV asking your indulgence ever so humbly before one and all to see if you would give that consideration. And if not, that's okay. It's not the end of the world for us. It's convenient. And if it's inconvenient to you, then don't do that. Is what I would advise you.
Any other comments? Mr. Steele, this is not a item that requires a motion. We need to give direction to staff.
Correct.
I'm going to ask if there's a concurrence with my motion. I think we need to look at what the goal is, and the goal is to get this money paid back as quickly as possible. And the scenario I laid out gets this money in our hands as quickly as possible. So unless there's objection, I'm going to
object. Okay. I think it's important, particularly for the people at home, to hear once again, Mr. Ochoa is not asking for debt relief at all. He's not asking for not having to pay the interest. The interest has been paid. I know there's a lot of misinformation that has been out there. But whether we get paid in October or whether we get paid in December, I don't think matters to most people. But I think in this environment, this is perceived to be some special treatment, whether it is or not, it's perceived to be, and people's perceptions become their reality. And I think I would be reluctant to support that.
Am I hearing objections from my other two colleagues or support?
I think I was pretty clear in terms of my position, but I too will object to it.
Mr. Spicer?
Well, if he's going to pay the $200,000 up front and just finance the $75,000 at 6 3/4, plus the city will be receiving their money, you know, ahead of time, it just seemed like the way to go to me. I can understand that, you know, people out in the community, we all are running into a hang-up, you know, within our mortgages and stuff, but if we're going to get the city money back within 90 days, I don't see a problem, because it would be taking longer to get the money.
I clearly heard Mr. Kemp and Mr. Jungmina say that we need this money in this city, and I agree. We need this money in this city. We've had a budget crisis since I don't know when, and having the money sooner than later will benefit this community now. Not in December, now.
And at a higher interest rate.
And we would receive a higher interest rate for the 90 days going forward. Maybe it's not politically correct, but economically, it makes more sense. So maybe I'm taking the non-political, but the economical, and the part that means more is that this money would be available to this community basically within 90 days of the close of his escrow. And I don't understand how it makes sense not to put the money back in the coffers of this city as quickly as possible. I don't understand that concept. If the goal is to get this loan paid back, then I think we do it as quickly as we can. And this would get it to us more expeditiously.
We're talking 3 months,
Marianne. Right, that's what I'm saying.
And I mean, to be honest with you again, it the bigger concern that I have is the precedent that we're setting, okay? I mean, again, 2004 was a totally different period of time.
You're right.
I have a harder time trying to wrap my head and my conscience around the notion when other people have lost their homes, other people have lost their jobs, and are going through the same economic challenges that most of us out there are facing right now. And yes, you're absolutely right. This city has had to go through their own budgetary constraints, similar. And my biggest fear is the idea that we're setting a precedent with this.
We would be, the precedent we're setting is if we make a loan like this in the future, which I don't know that we ever will again. I think, you know, someone said those days are gone, and I agree, those days are gone. I think the example is our new city manager, Ms. Lyle, was not afforded that same kind of a loan. What we have asked Ms. Lyle to do is move to our community. She is in escrow, ready to make that move.
Closed escrow.
And what we have offered Ms. Lyle is a budget for moving facilities. The decision to make the loan was a different day. You're absolutely correct, and everybody on this council agreed to it. The situation that we find us in now is a completely different animal and a different day. one of the questions was, you know, have other citizens come to you and asked for you to help forgive their loans or to help pay their loans? We are the bank, per se, for Mr. Ochoa on this loan. And banks are being asked and encouraged all across this country to evaluate loans and cut deals for homeowners. We're not being asked to cut a deal. We're being asked if they can pay part of it up, a big chunk of it up front, and then the rest of it within 90 days. The precedents we would be making, in my opinion, would be to put money into the coffers of this city expeditiously. So unless anybody has any other solutions, we are at a stymie point.
I appreciate.
Do you have suggestions?
I appreciate the discussion on the council, and I will talk to Mr. Ochoa and see if there's any other options to pursue, and report back at the next meeting for the council if there's any other considerations that we come up with, and or whether we should close out this issue and let the existing notes and deed of trust and stand as they should be. So I will work with Mr. Ochoa to see if there's any other options we can identify.
I guess I just need to ask one question about that. If we do not have some sort of a decision here, does that mean that Mr. Ochoa's house will not close?
I don't know what Mr. Ochoa's situation is. That's up to Mr. Ochoa.
Okay.
I would be incredibly surprised if Mr. Ochoa's house could close without our willingness to take action on the deed of trust. But we will discuss it in more detail, find out if there are any other options to pursue, and I will report back to the council at the next meeting.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for the comments, and Mr. Ochoa, for your being here to answer our questions this evening. Okay, we had some items pulled off the consent calendar this evening, and we need to take those items up. First item is CC5, and in just a moment I'll tell you what it is. CC5 is a support services agreement between the City of Monrovia and the Monrovia Chamber of Commerce in the amount of $48,688. And Mr. Dan Bell, can you give us a very brief information about what this item is?
Sure. Thank you, Madam Mayor and City Council. What this is an extension of the contract existing that just expired on June 30th with the Monrovia Chamber of Commerce. And what this does basically extends the contract that we've had with them for services to support the city, both through citywide events and many services that they both help us out with and provide to the community, mainly to our residents and our business community. This is the same amount that last year's contract was for, and staff is looking to move forward with an agreement with the Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you. I do have a speaker card on this. Mr. Cyrus Kemp.
Good evening, Council. I haven't seen this current contract, but I would suspect that it's just a continuation of the contract that's been in place for a number of years. I addressed this concern once before, and I'm going to address it again. The part of this money that is given the chamber is to put out a publication that lists the businesses within the city of Monrovia. And the publication that the chamber puts out under that contract only lists the businesses who belong to the chamber members. That's not what the contract calls for. And that really isn't good for the city of Monrovia. I think it behooves the chamber, if it's serving the city, to make sure that all businesses end up in that directory. And when someone calls a chamber, that the chamber recommends a business that's within Monrovia, rather than saying Monrovia doesn't have that type of business because that particular business hasn't joined the chamber. And this has occurred. So I would ask the council to ask Mr. Bell to pay a little bit more attention to what the chamber is and isn't doing with regard to the contract. And also just the welfare of the city. Why send our business to another community and have them get sales tax credits when we have that business here, but the chamber is ignoring it because it hasn't seen fit to become a member of the chamber? And sometimes that is an expensive proposition, and a lot of these little business people are experiencing financial difficulties today, and sometimes joining the chamber just is not an option. But I still think that if the chamber is serving the community, it would want to include all businesses. And if somebody called for a reference to a particular type of business, to have them told that no, we don't have anybody that does that here or sells that here, does not serve the interests of the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Ms. Crehan, the director of the Chamber of Commerce. Yes, you may speak.
Thank you, Mayor and Council, for hearing me out. I just want to address what Cyrus said about the chamber directory. Actually, the last issue, we did have it open to any business. And also, if someone calls our chamber and asks us for a business and we know of that business, we don't tell the person there is no such business if there is that business in Monrovia. We know about them. That is not true. We do a lot of things for the city of Monrovia. We love this town. We have a presence on Myrtle. We have started several years ago at the advice and help of Council Member Adams, a shop local campaign that has been very helpful. We always stress to anybody that comes in our office that shopping here keeps your dollars here, and we need you to do that, especially in these times. We also help the city in communicating to the businesses in the community as well as residents. We weekly send out an email update of not only our events but your events and any nonprofit or actually just about anybody in town, an entity that would like to put the word out to anybody that's on our email list. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions?
I wanted to make a comment. In terms of reaching out to businesses that aren't members to the chamber, the Beacon Committee, which is the Business Education and Community Outreach Network, they present a beautification award, community service awards, and courtesy awards. And you do not have to be a chamber member to receive that. In fact, several of the awards that we have that the chamber has given, and I've been at those ceremonies, they're not chamber members. We encourage them to become chamber members, but through that committee, they actually make a special effort to acknowledge what businesses do in the community. And we hope that someday they be chamber members, but there's no requirement for that. I just wanted to let you know.
Yeah, I can tell you, I've been the council liaison to the chamber for quite some time now, and I know personally the number of phone calls that the chamber gets during the year that really aren't even business related that should probably come to City Hall is a huge number of calls. And if you look at the cost of this, that's probably the equivalent of one good receptionist
during the year, and I think we get a lot of bang for our buck. And I would move that we approve this.
I'll second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Council. This motion passes. And the next item that was pulled was CC7, which is a management agreement with Madhouse Creation Incorporated in the amount of $1,800. Am I saying that right? Yeah.
A month.
For the period ending June 30th, 2012, and Dan Bell will give us the report again.
Thank you again, Mayor Lutz and Council. Yes, what this agreement is moving forward both on the current agreement we have with them. They were formerly known as Ewing and Bland, and they have redesigned our site in the past, and they have helped us with the hosting and maintaining and design things like that on our city's website, which by many accounts is award-winning, and people like that site. But in an effort to move forward, staff would like to have more functions on our site so that we can provide a better customer service to our community and mainly to visitors of our city, whether they be e-visitors or here in person with smartphones moving forward. So what this would do, it moves forward with maintenance and also a redesign of the website at this price of $1,800 per month, totaling $21,600 total for the year. This is a one-year agreement with them, which includes the redesign for only this year. And what this would be is they would design templates so that staff would like to see, once you hit the homepage of Monrovia, you know you're at Monrovia as you click off on the other sites. It's a uniform look, almost a branding campaign. Excuse me. And then the content would be updated. You've seen this with the police department's page, the fire department. This is the way we're going. But also the important part of this redesign here is to add tabs and different components by updating Joomla. We're in Joomla 2.0, and this would bring us up to 2.5. It's worth noting also that this has some security features that would help us in the incidents like when we had that hacking. It just changes and updates and would make it easier to go to the Joomla 3.0.
What is Joomla?
Joomla is the system that runs it. Sorry. Okay, I'm just learning all this too, so this is good
stuff.
A little
bug that flies around this.
Right, but the key here is that it adds these components where we can get things like adding online business applications or special events permits, things where people have to come to the counter now, people would be able to do online and submit. So it makes us more customer friendly and more functional to our residents and visitors. So that is what's before you tonight.
Thank you. We do have a speaker card, Cyrus Kemp.
Good evening. I first learned about this item on those terrible blogs that Marianne hates.
Becky
or Becky, excuse me. Becky hates.
I'm not crazy about them either.
But they do serve a useful purpose sometimes because they tend to alert you to some things that may go past you. And this was one. This is one of these things that, you know, in the scheme of things, is it a lot of money? Probably not, but, you know, when you take all these little buckets of money and you pour them in a big pile, they do begin to add up. I really, really question diving into this without looking for some alternatives. I know we have Mal Sierra down here. I wasn't aware that we'd been hacked, but my little bit of rudimentary experience with websites is generally you're going to get hacked. It's either a password issue, or it's your web host that is the issue. I would say that spending money redesigning the site might be a nice thing, but, you know, paving the streets might be a nice thing too. It's just coming to the point to where a lot of window dressing that's costing us, you know, $15,000 here, $20,000 there. You know, when it's all said and done, it's a lot of money. Would pay off Mr. Choa's loan pretty quick there, wouldn't it? You know, I haven't seen in the little bit of the report that I read on it, we didn't seem to take any bids on this. Not a whole lot of information, just a kind of a scenario like was given here a few minutes ago by Dan Bell, which is all great. Hey, these things are great. You know, I embrace technology and I appreciate it and see what it can do for you. But I also know that sometimes you can go overboard with it and it ends up costing you a lot of money. And I just question whether that's the best place to be putting the money right now. I would like to see the council take a harder look at this. Maybe Mount Sierra down there could take on a class project and redesign our website. There's a lot of ways to accomplish things without just writing checks all the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bell, I do have one question for you. How much
Absolutely.
Are we paying right now for our web hosting?
Actually, the contract now, this came up, it was based on maintenance for the work that they had done in the past. And so we're looking at this. So it kind of breaks down the $9,600 you see in the report there is for the actual redesign work, which from what I hear from our IT staff is a really good price, and I hate to say that because it is a really good price, but our early estimates when we are looking at doing a redesign on the low end were somewhere in the $30,000 to $40,000 just for a redesign of what they'll do. These folks have been doing our site and did the last redesign, and so all respect to the students there, we're getting trained professionals here to do this work on top of maintaining and doing the design work they've already been done. And this price of this $21,000 is lower than the prices we were looking at for a redesign alone. Plus, we're still getting the service that we were getting from this company that knows our website and works with it daily.
Now, I also understand that one of the plans for this new website is that we will be able to put some of our planning procedures online. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us what that might be and what the benefits to doing that are?
Yeah, and there's actually more than that. And building plans, not just applications or things like this, but down the road, our IT department would like to put a component in there, and this would help us get down that road where a contractor could actually submit their plans to our staff, which would streamline that process tremendously. There are also functions that would work under this new plan pretty quickly where we talked about graffiti and asking our residents to come out and report this. There are things that you can do through GPS tracking where you can take a picture and send it to Public Works. And so what this would do under this would send this to the appropriate departments and get our community engaged as we've asked them to do. And also, as Mr. Kemp said, potholes. This is another component. Potholes, graffiti, different things that we can do with this new system that would get us where we are talking about going in the field of customer service and getting our citizens engaged. As far as the price, this is fair for everything we would be getting.
Thank you.
Dan, if this is the company that currently has it, and this is the company that had it when we got hacked, mm-hmm. has anyone determined what went wrong?
And I am no expert here, but from what I hear and
neither am I. Just
yeah,
layman's terms.
Yeah, layman's terms. One thing with this redesign, like I mentioned, this Joomla 2.0 to 2.5 has added buffers and would help us keep the hackers away. If hackers want to get in, hackers will get in. But you're always trying to do the best you can to keep them out, and so this would help with that. If
then,
that answers your question.
And then my next question might be more for Mark. Applying for water service online? Will we be able to apply for water service through this new and improved website?
Yes.
Yes?
We can add the application.
Thank you.
Any other?
Don't listen to Cyrus. He just got brand new yellow lines right in front of his house. They repainted the lights in front, right down his street.
there any other questions of staff?
Yeah, I do.
Sure.
Dan, one of the things that I know that other websites have offered is some of the streaming capabilities. And I realize that a lot of times when someone is wanting to look at the council meeting, they're tending to have to move away from over to another site.
Go to KGEM. Yeah.
Is there a way that we can somehow link the two together so that we can?
I'm not the expert, but I would I would have to look into that. I would imagine it'd be possible.
I would hate to
say yes and be wrong.
Well, the big thing will be how much bandwidth do they give you? Because if you get 50 people trying to watch videos at the same time, yeah, and you don't have adequate bandwidth, it's not going to work. So how much bandwidth is it, Dan?
I could find out for you, sir.
Something for information purposes.
Absolutely, yes. But you know, this company, like I said, they've worked with us for years and done our site, and they're willing, obviously, by their proposal and to work with us further to get us where we want to be. You know, I mean, we can talk about Twitter and Facebook feeds on the bottom is something we're talking about, so our residents can see that. They don't have to go to the Facebook. They're on our website, almost like a ticker on the bottom. We talked about banners with photos. So many different things this would allow us to do.
How long will it take for the redesign?
What I hear is up to 4 months we could be up and running, and that's getting it out to the public and saying go here and look at it and putting it out on the street.
In all joking aside, I think if you, because we've got some very talented people in town, mm-hmm, if you could reach out to some of those folks and maybe get a beta team together to kind of test this as you go, and give you an idea of what works, what doesn't work. Don't just rely on the professionals that you're paying. Get, mm-hmm, some people who use this stuff. We've got the students. We've got a lot of really talented people in Monrovia.
And I think we saw that at the CEO reception at Mount Sierra. I mean, there's those kids there. Get some ideas, kind of, you know, what Facebook does. They throw ideas around, and those become, you know, implemented plans.
One of the first things you could do is put a little banner on their current site saying we're getting ready to redesign this. Let people volunteer to be on that beta team. And
it's a good idea.
Good.
Okay. Any other questions, comments?
I move we approve the agreement with Madhouse Creative.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. This motion carries. This concludes our meeting so far, or this evening, and we will be closing in the memory of two people this evening. First, one of our family members has passed away, our retired Monrovia Police Sergeant Ron Buck, who served in this community for many, many years, passed away in the last week, and our thoughts and prayers are with his family. And then one of our other family members who contributes to this community and with his nonprofit basketball program, Rodney Jefferson, who is the director of A Games Fundamentals, mother passed away just a day or so ago. Lily Jefferson was a member of the Monrovia and or Duarte community her whole life and attended the Monrovia Arcadia Duarte High School. And of course, we know that she raised a son who has been giving back to our community for many years. So our thoughts and prayers go out to the Jefferson family this week as well. And with that, our next council meeting will be Tuesday, July 17th at 7:30 in these chambers, and we are adjourned.